In this video lecture, I'm going to refresh some fundamental concepts of vectors which you already know. I will therefore not spend much time in explanations. Let's review the basic properties of vectors. A vector is an entity that has a magnitude and a direction. In three-dimensional Cartesian basis, we can write a vector in terms of how much we need to move along each axis. I always use an arrow to represent vectors, and a hat to represent unit vectors, which have a magnitude of 1. I use x hat, y hat, and z hat to represent the three unit vectors directed along the three axes of space. Some people use the letters I, j, and k. If we specify the basis being used, we can just write down the vector as a collection of its three components, like this. The magnitude or length of a vector can be calculated using Pythagoras' theorem. What are the operations that we can do on vectors? There are several. We can add them. Geometrically, vectors are added by placing them one after the other. In component form, we add the corresponding components. We can also scale vectors, multiplying them by a scalar. In component form, we just multiply all of the components by the same number, alpha. And this scales the vector. Combining addition and multiplication by a scalar, we can do linear combinations of vectors. V equals alpha A plus beta B. Notice that if we set alpha equal to 1 and beta equal to minus 1, this is the same as subtraction of vectors. Doing linear combinations of vectors can actually be very, very useful. For example, imagine we have our origin here, and we have two points in space, which are identified by vectors A and B. If we want to find the vector that joins A to B, that's very easy. This vector is given by B minus A, the subtraction of both. Remember when subtracting that you always put where you want to go, and you subtract where you come from. If you want to find the midpoint of the line joining the two points, you can do it also very easily by doing A plus B divided by 2. That is the average of vectors A and B. And actually you can do much more if you introduce a vector V given by a linear combination of vectors A and B. As we will now see, this linear combination can have very special properties if we require the condition that alpha plus beta equals 1, where alpha is the weighting coefficient of vector A, and beta, which equals 1 minus alpha, is the weighting coefficient of vector B. Notice that if alpha equals 1, then we get vector A. If alpha equals 0, then we get vector B. If alpha equals 1/2, then we get the midpoint, vector C. In fact, any value of alpha will give us a different point along the line joining the two points. Which other operations can we do on vectors? Can we multiply two vectors? Mathematicians define two useful ways of doing this. The scalar product, also called dot product, denoted by A dot B, and the vector product, also called cross product, denoted by A cross B. These two are very different. Let's start with the dot product. Let's imagine the dot product as a machine that has for input two vectors and it outputs a number equal to the dot product of A dot B. This number is defined to be equal to the magnitude of A times the magnitude of B times the cosine of the angle between A and B. Let's see how we can interpret the dot product geometrically. Here we have two vectors, A and B. We are seeing the magnitude of both vectors and we are seeing the dot product between them. These circles represent a circle of radius 1, 2, 3, and so on. The dot product can be interpreted as the magnitude of vector B multiplied by the projection of vector A onto vector B, which would be this distance here. Therefore, the dot product is 2 times 1.5, which is 3. If we move vector A, for example, we can make vector A such that its projection is 2. Now, the length of vector B is 2, the projection of vector A is 2, so the dot product is 2 times 2 equals 4. The dot product will change sign when vector A's projection points in the opposite direction to vector B, as you can see here. Also notice that the dot product doesn't care about the order in which you do the operation. For example, if we swap the positions of A and B, the dot product will still be 2.66. A very common and useful thing to do is to do the dot product in which one of the two vectors is a unit vector with length 1. For example, I have just made B to be a unit vector, and therefore A dot B is simply equal to the projection of A in the direction of B. For example, if A has an x component of 2, then the dot product is 2. If the projection of A into B is of length 1, then the dot product is 1. If we move vector B to still be a unit vector but in another direction, then the result is the projection of A in that new direction. In fact, you can easily see that if a vector B is written as bx x plus by y plus bz z, then the dot product of v dot x unit vector is equal to vx, because we are getting the component in the x direction. Similarly for y and z. And what about the dot product between two unit vectors? For example, here A and V are both unit vectors because they are in the unit sphere. Then what we see is that the dot product varies between 1 and minus 1. And the dot product is 0 whenever the two vectors are orthogonal to each other. Knowing this, we can find an analytical way to calculate the dot product using the components. For example, A dot B can be written using the components. And now we can multiply out these two parentheses, bearing in mind that we are doing a dot product. Therefore, we get the following. Now, we know that the dot product of vectors x hat times x hat must equal 1, y hat times y hat also equals 1, and the same for z hat times z hat. While all the others must equal 0, because the unit vectors are orthogonal to each other. Therefore, the dot product can be mathematically written in this very simple way. Now, what about the cross product? The cross product is very different to the dot product because it's like a machine which has two vectors as its input and produces a vector as its output. This new vector has a magnitude equal to the magnitude of A times the magnitude of B times the sine of the angle between A and B, and it has a direction C hat, which is perpendicular to both A and B. Also, the direction of C is determined by the right-hand rule. Let's see an example. Here, we have a geometric representation of the cross product. We see vector A, vector B, and the cross product vector A cross B. This circle is for reference, and it has a radius of 1. The first thing to notice is that the vector A cross B is directed perpendicular to both A and B. It's perpendicular to the plane that contains vectors A and B. And it is pointing in a direction defined by the right-hand rule. If your right-hand fingers move from vector A to vector B, then your right thumb finger points in the direction of A cross B. Moving vector A to the other side of B reverses the direction of the cross product, according to the right-hand rule. This, by the way, is the reason that A cross B is not equal to B cross A, because they have exactly an opposite sign. The second thing to notice is that the length of vector A cross B is equal to the area of the parallelogram formed by the vectors A and B. When the two vectors are parallel, the area is zero, and therefore the cross product is zero. If the two vectors are orthogonal, then the parallelogram turns into a rectangle, and therefore the length of A cross B is simply the product of the length of A times the length of B. As an interesting case, what if the two vectors are unit vectors? In this case, the cross product ranges from 0 when they are parallel, then it slowly increases until it reaches 1 when they are orthogonal, then it starts decreasing again, and it's 0 when they are anti-parallel, increases again in the opposite direction until it reaches minus 1 when they are orthogonal, and then it goes to 0 when they are parallel again. For example, it is easy to see that if we plot the Cartesian unit vectors x, y, and z, then following the rules that we just described, it is quite easy to see that x cross y is equal to z. We can do the same for other combinations of unit vectors. For example, y cross x is equal to minus z, or y cross z is equal to x. This can be very useful if we want to find the cross product using only the components of the vectors. Following a similar procedure as we did for the dot product, we can say that A cross B is equal to the components of A cross the components of B. We can now expand these two brackets, but remembering that we have to do the cross product, and we get the following expansion. Now we can simplify some of these cross products between unit vectors. For example, all the ones that are with themselves will be equal to 0, while all the other combinations can be figured out if we draw quickly the three unit vectors x, y, z, and then we can figure out what all the cross products are by using the right-hand rule, so that we can finally write the following mathematical formula for the cross product between two vectors in Cartesian coordinates. When we learn about determinants, we will see that to remember this mathematical form, we can just write the following determinant, which gives us a nice, simple way to write the cross product in terms of the components of the vectors. Probably you already knew everything that I said in this video, so I would like to end it with something that is new and hopefully interesting. Using the right-hand rule when calculating the cross product is an arbitrary choice. It is purely an arbitrary convention which works great as long as we always stick to it. But we could redo all of science and mathematics from scratch by choosing a left-hand rule convention for the cross product. Everything would work exactly the same. Bridges would not fall, nuclear reactors would not explode, but all of our textbooks and homework exercises would have all vector quantities which depend on cross products reversed in sign. For example, the angular momentum vector of a rotating disk, the magnetic field vector created by a current, the torque acting on an object when we apply a force, and so on. All these vectors are calculated using cross products, and therefore, their orientation is determined arbitrarily by the right-hand rule convention. The vectors whose sign depends on this convention are called pseudovectors, where pseudo is Greek for lying or false. After some careful thought about this, you might arrive at an apparent paradox. For example, what happens with the magnetic force acting on a charge moving through a magnetic field? This force is given by a cross product. So how can the convention have anything to do with it? The particle will either turn in one direction or in the other. We can do an experiment to determine which sign the force has. So how is this possible? The answer is that since B is a pseudovector that itself comes from a cross product, then by applying the cross product again, we arrive at a force F which is independent of which convention we choose, exactly as it should. Thanks for listening. This is the first video I've done for this mathematics course, and I hope there will be many more. Thank you.